Now I'm really excited. I'll be joined in conversation in this upcoming chat by Jamie Brown. Jamie is a registered yoga teacher as well as a DEAI consultant. Jamie is currently transitioning into a role as a full-time consultant after working at Georgetown University since 2016. Through her work, she has been acknowledged with various accolades for her commitment to the community. She remains an adjunct career instructor and is an MBA student at Georgetown University. Prior to this graduate program, Jamie earned her master's from New York University and her bachelor's from Rutgers. Outside of work, Jamie is a wellness advocate as a registered yoga teacher with a trauma-informed certification, and she runs outdoor fitness series in her home area of Mercer County, New Jersey. So welcome, Jamie. I'm so excited to get to talk to you today.
Hello, Meg. Happy Monday. It is Jamae, like Jamaica.
Thank you. Oh my goodness. I'm so sorry. Jamae.
Yes.
Thank you for correcting me. All right. So let's jump in here. I want to learn a little bit more about you and how you cracked the code to networking. Where would you like to start with this?
Yeah, I'll start with, I'm still cracking the code, right? I do think that most of my networking would happen virtually through LinkedIn. It's one of my favorite platforms. So it wasn't a huge pivot or transition when COVID happened and everything seemed to be virtual. But I'll say, outside of LinkedIn and that helping me connect with folks, really using my people, right? My personal and professional references and contacts to say, here's what I'm looking to do, whether it was a professional transition or just a training or a skill I was looking to build. And maybe they say, oh, I know Meg and she's at Power to Fly and I think she'd be a great person for you to talk to. So using your people, but also LinkedIn and other platforms that were already virtual, but using them even more.
I can't agree more there. So we've talked a little bit about, you know, kind of the tools that can be most helpful for networking during COVID. I know that Zoom was incredibly popular for a lot of people. And then we kind of got hit. I mean, I feel like it's happened multiple times. We've kind of like rocketed back and forth a little bit on the idea of Zoom fatigue and the screen fatigue that goes with it. And have you experienced the same kind of like ebbs and flows in seeing this rush of like, hey, this tool is really working, but then it kind of, you know, kind of come like boomerangs back into everyone's sick of this. Have you experienced that at all?
Absolutely. I learned very quickly how helpful it was to see my colleagues, right? To see your face while we have this conversation, but also to do that with 6 30-minute meetings back to back was just not feasible, right? So I became really strategic about either putting blocks on my calendar or saying, hey, do you mind if we're camera off? And in that case, we can just do the phone, right? So knowing when I usually got tired throughout the day and needed to transition to camera off, but also when there's power and obviously being able to see who I'm talking to so that we can gauge like, oh yes, they're vibing with me. This is a good conversation.
I love that you bring that up, right? Because there's different, there's a bunch of different channels that you can use. There's Zoom, there's Teams, there's a whole bunch of them. And I love the idea of sort of trying to highlight some of the different uses or maybe the different functionalities they have. Mm-hmm. Slack is a go-to one for Power to Fly to communicate internally, but it's also been hugely impactful for other groups that have adopted it. And I don't know if you've gotten a chance to check it out yet, but their huddle feature is really cool. And it's kind of along those same lines where it's the idea of connecting with people and giving you the more of the ease and the organicness of dropping into someone's office or, you know, on your way back from the water cooler, stopping in to be like, oh, hey, I see you guys are talking about blah, blah, blah. I'd love to drop in for a second, then you leave. And it doesn't have the visual component with it, which seemed a bit odd to me until we got to hear about the reasons behind it and the idea that, you know, mentally and psychologically seeing ourselves on screens. And I've been doing this for 3 years. I can absolutely attest to this. Once you are watching yourself in real time on a screen, it's like you're standing in front of a mirror while you're talking to everyone else. It starts to mess with you a little bit. Yeah, you still look for those like nonverbal and sometimes verbal, mm-hmm. Exceptions or encouragement from others. But even, and the Slack people were really great about talking about how as women, we're very socialized to think about our work quality in tandem along with our physical appearance and how hard that can be when you're struggling with all of these other things and, you know, a literal pandemic around you. And yet you're still thinking about things like, oh, I forgot to put on lipstick for today's Zoom call or something. It's nuts, right? Have you been, you know, kind of diving into these other tools as well, or do you prefer to kind of stick with like, these are the things that I need to make this networking session go easily or go better for me? Do you investigate that at all, or do you just kind of go with what's there?
Probably more so going with what's there. I use Zoom a ton, right? Because I have to use it for work and school. So I'm used to that platform. Naturally, Slack is helpful too. I haven't used the Huddle feature yet, so I'll definitely check that out. But in terms of camera off, camera on, I am quick to hide self-view if I think that it is distracting me from the conversation, or like I said earlier, make the suggestion to be camera off. And in addition, just going back to what I said earlier too about putting blocks on my calendar, right? Like I was joking in preparation for this conversation, talking to folks about how my social stamina just isn't what it used to be. You know what I mean? So I also, like I said, recognize when, whether it's Zoom, Slack, whatever it is, when I just need to take a break for myself in general so I can come back recharged.
I love that. Thank you for sharing that with us. All right. So in terms of obviously kind of expanding on the idea of COVID-19 and how that's been impacting a lot of us, mm-hmm. let's talk about social stamina and kind of the ways this has been impacting us. Can you give us real quick before you answer about what you think the impacts have been, can you give us a brief definition of social stamina, maybe for people who haven't heard that concept before, or maybe just haven't had it articulated in like in a phrase, and they'll think like, oh my gosh, yes, that's exactly what I'm thinking of.
Yeah, I think of it as the ability to engage in conversation and interaction and it not drain you, right? So you still feel good, rejuvenated by, hey, this person, hey, that person, how's this going? You know, all of those, all of the many interactions that you could have in a day.
I think that's a good way to put it. Okay, so when it comes to our social stamina, people, I feel like there's been a large shift, right? There were people mm-hmm. that were fine because the pandemic was happening and they're already introverted and they were fine. There were some people that were extroverts that we were kind of trying to check on, you know, 2-3 months into the pandemic, because some people need that interpersonal stimulation. Let's talk a little bit about how those interests and interactions have really changed over the course of the pandemic. Cause like we talked about, you kind of have, you know, a surge in one direction and then it kind of rebounds comes back in a different way. So how have you seen like how this social stamina plays out in, you know, in general or just with yourself?
Yeah, I'll speak for myself first. So definitely think I can ebb and flow as an ambivert, right? I think there are moments when I need to be around the people to get good energy, especially working in higher ed. I work with students. I want to make sure they're having a great college experience. That's important. But when I need to lock in, I need to do so most of the time alone, independent work. And that's really leans into my introverted side. So as an ambivert, somebody who can ebb and flow, I didn't know how I was going to quite respond to COVID and not seeing my colleagues and my students as often as I was used to. But I quickly am learning now that things are back in person, still in a pandemic, of course, but I am having more in-person interactions than I was earlier, that it's not the same, especially with the mask on too. And like people can't really read if I'm smiling, and there are so many factors, right? So I would say that my social stamina has definitely changed. I'll always speak and say hello, excuse me, but I'm not super inclined to say, how are you? Especially if I can't stick around for the answer, whether it's time or I'm just tired, right? So we'll catch up soon. Quick, right? But if I do have the time and energy, I do want to know how folks are doing and I will ask. So I've noticed changes in my own social stamina. I've heard from friends and just anecdotally that people are feeling pretty similar, right? So I'm curious to see how it plays out when more workplaces, institutions, organizations are fully open, no masks, just seeing if folks get back to what was normal before.
Yes, for sure. I think that'll be very interesting. I don't think it's going to happen as soon as people think it might be. But yeah, I think you're right. I think it's going to be a new thing. It's going to be something completely different than we've ever had to really tackle before, at least in most of our lifetimes. And so, yeah, that's going to be interesting. So there's a lot of conflicting opinions about whether networking online is easier than networking in person. Now, I have a lot of opinions on this subject as someone whose whole job is to encourage this kind of networking and to do it entirely in the virtual space. But what's your opinion on this? Do you think it's easier to do it in person or online?
I'm enjoying online. I like being able to set up, you know, time that's convenient for both of us. Again, having that camera on option to mimic in person or camera off and that feel even more comfortable, not necessarily casual, but comfortable. And I also think that when I do it online, I am quicker to, I set up these things, right? So Meg, you and I are meeting for the first time and we had a great conversation about diversity, equity, and inclusion in the workplace, right? So it's quicker for me after our online conversation to set up. I try to check in with my folks every other month and I'll say, hey, Meg, we touched base in September. It was a great conversation. Wanted to update you on what I'm working on and see how you've been. So I can set those reminders. It's just little things like that that make online a little easier for me. And then beyond all of that, like in person, interactions are still odd. We already talked about masks. There's distance. I got to, you know, elbow bump you instead of shake your hand. So I'm all for virtual.
I'm in the same boat. I very much appreciate the virtual networking realm. I mean, not the least of which, because you can network with people that you might never have had a chance to even cross paths with. You know, it really does open up so much space that something like geography would have very easily prevented someone from participating before. So yeah, I absolutely love that. And you're right. There are a lot of aspects of, you know, like the technologically involved society that we live in now, there are a lot of ways to you know, build those reminders in, things that would really help you in that networking process, as well, like you said, kind of deepening that relationship. That it's not that you can't do it with physical networking. You can, you know, set up a reminder on your phone to email this person and blah, blah. But I feel like you're right. When you're already kind of immersed in that tech space while you're doing it, it's quite easy to just jump over and be like, hey, set that reminder, blah, blah, blah. Like,
absolutely.
I absolutely love that.
Yes. I love your point about geography. Yeah. I should have started with that. Of course. Like now I don't have to only network with people in New Jersey or at Georgetown, like folks are all over. So yes.
It is great. I can't tell you how much I love it. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's kind of open up into a broader perspective here. And let's kind of talk in terms of, you know, somebody wants to learn more about a company or is seeking a referral for a particular job. What would your recommendation be to approach this from a networking perspective? Because I feel like the ways that we used to do this pre-pandemic, and even the ways like I was taught how to do this when I graduated, you know, when I was going through college or through high school programs, the ways I was taught to do this are completely different and basically irrelevant now. So let's, you know, what way would you tell people to approach, you know, this idea of seeking out a referral or seeking out info about a company from a networking perspective?
Yeah, I appreciate this question because I teach an undergrad career class. So this, I'm going to start with what I teach my undergraduate students at Georgetown. So I tell them first to figure out, again, who is in their network, right? Family included. Where does mom and dad work, guardian, whoever? What else? On the school side, think about what Georgetown connections you may have with folks. If you have recent seniors who were your friends that graduated, where are they now? Start there with your people. Again, your sort of inner circle. See if and how they can connect you. But virtually, I encourage them to go on LinkedIn. That's the main platform that I sort of promote for them. And type in, there's a feature where you can type in, you know, Georgetown alum. Or if you go to Georgetown University, click the alumni tab or people tab, you can see what alumni work at what companies, right? Based on an industry or company you're interested in. And I think that cold emailing, when you have that personal connection, is helpful. If I were to just email Meg Alexander out of nowhere, you may or may not read it, but you're unlikely to respond. But if I say, hey, Meg, I don't know if we met before, but I've been following Power to Fly for a long time. I also see that you're from dot, dot, dot. You went to dot, dot, dot school, whatever it is, finding a point of personal connection for us, I'm more likely to get a response. So that's what I tell my undergraduate students to do. Again, if they know someone who knows Meg, great. If not, if Meg went to Georgetown with them, they're good and should get a response, like I said. And then from there, that follow-up, I tell people every other month feels appropriate, but if it needs to be more recent because you are looking for an internship for spring now, maybe it's every month, right? For the general person outside of my undergrads, I think those same sort of steps could work, but naturally as professionals, our networks are a bit wider and vast, right? But I don't know if we as adults, outside of college adults, maintain them in the same ways that college students do. People are more inclined to just help college students than they are people who aren't in undergrad, right? So just making sure that we find a steady flow with our networking, we attend conferences and events like this, just finding ways to get creative and not forget some of either what we had in undergrad or some of the things that I mentioned earlier.
That's a really good point. You're right. There are a lot of opportunities that are much more open to undergrad or people who are maybe fresh out of college. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like everybody at least a little bit remembers what that was like. You know, you have this like somewhat, you think you're an adult and then you graduate and you're like, oh God, no, I've totally been like on the adult light end. And now you're kind of just thrown into the deep end of that pool. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I love that. Also, your research is fabulous. I did go to da-da-da school. So thank you so much for that.
Yes, made that up.
So when we're using this LinkedIn approach to networking to kind of help us secure like an internship or a referral or whatever, mm-hmm. how do you make that first ask to secure a phone conversation or a Zoom call? Because personally, I have a very hard time doing this because I feel awkward asking somebody for something. You know, there's a lot of other millennials, Gen Z, Gen X that'll tell you like, well, I'm not good with phone calls. I'm not good with this, not good with that. And so how do you kind of push past that feeling of awkwardness to get, that first concrete connection to really develop that connection with that person?
Yeah, it's not easy. That's for sure. But I think there has to be give and take. So if I reach out, hello, X person, I see that you work for this company. And I see our personal connection here. Hoping that we could talk further about my resume, which I'm actively working to elevate or upgrade as I apply for positions. Beyond just asking for your advice, I'd also love to offer. Now, here's where it gets tricky because we all have different things we can offer. I usually offer sharing job posts with my undergraduate students. I work at a college. It seems to work for me, right? If you are not in my position or don't have the ability to do that, think about what you can offer. I'd love to just offer to talk about something you recently posted or my take on this, your company's new initiative, whatever, right? Just trying to offer something though to make it seem like you aren't just like, thanks for the resume review, chat whenever, but how can you again keep the conversation going? Or what else? Other things I'll bring up are, very cool conferences and events that I just went to, especially related to diversity, equity, and inclusion. And I figured I'd share that I recently checked out Power to Fly's Diversity Reboot Summit, right? And wanted to share it in case it's within your interest. If not, all good, but I found it really helpful. Boom. That you're offering something in that moment. So I think that makes the ask a little easier because you're also giving something.
I love that. I absolutely love that. And you know what? I sit through a bunch of these like 3 to 5 times a week and I always have a mind blown moment. And this is like my third so far with talking with you. but yeah, I've never thought about it in terms of like your offer could be like, hey, I heard of this thing. I don't know if you've also heard of it, but it might be interesting or useful to you. I love that. Cause you're right. Like, you know, we get into these grooves and it's very much like, can I pick your brain? Can we mm-hmm. grab a cup of coffee? Can we, and it's like, not only are these not actual asks, it's one of those things that just is kind of hackneyed. And if you have something specific, like, hey, this is something I saw this and thought of you, is a lot lower of a lift for, hey, here's something that you could do that does make it feel a lot more transactional and less one-sided. I do want to jump in to maintaining that kind of professional relationship, but we did have mm-hmm. a really great question from the chat that I'd like to jump into if you would like. Dana had asked, I would love to know from Jemay her advice for networking with DEI professionals as someone who is interested in breaking into that space. So I think this connects with a lot of our audience who are maybe in a pivot position in their careers and not just entering into the workforce. But if you are, you know, trying to make a pivot into something like DEI, which is huge and important right now, and we want to keep that momentum going and keep getting people involved that can help make these changes that we obviously sorely need to make. What are your networking suggestions for somebody like that who's pivoting as opposed to just starting out?
Yeah, Dana, thank you for the question. I was in a similar boat, right? I just left higher ed on Friday, started in this full-time DE&I role today, right?
And
I was
congratulations. Like, thank you for letting us in on your first day.
Yes, thank you. So I'm trying to navigate that pivot. Yes, there's some overlap, but I didn't have clear DE&I experience on my resume in the ways that I wanted to. So I started out, again, just looking at who did I know that was doing DE&I work. Going on LinkedIn, typing in the word diversity, clicking people and seeing who had that in their title. I think about a few personal folks that I know who were doing DE&I work and then professional ones. So that was super helpful for me. And the ask, like what Meg and I just talked about, felt even lighter. Like we know each other outside of work things. So it was quick for me to be like, hey, I'm trying to get into DE&I. Like, how did you make that transition really clearly? What else? Something else that worked for me. And again, this won't apply for everybody. In addition to working full-time professionally, I'm an MBA student. So I was able to get an internship in DE&I, which really helped propel me into DE&I work because now I can speak to it from a corporate perspective and a higher ed perspective. So I know everybody can't take on another 20-hour work responsibility, but figuring out if you can go to great. But again, conferences and events are helpful. Joining different Slack groups around this topic, different LinkedIn groups, and then several key leaders in DE&I across industries in the corporate world are constantly on LinkedIn Live, constantly doing talks. I think going to some of those events to network would be super helpful.
I love those ideas. Thank you for sharing those. Mm-hmm. And hopefully those are useful for Dana as well as to anybody else in our group that, because I know in the last few months, we've had a lot of people like asking about pivoting into this space. So mm-hmm. That makes me very encouraged for where these changes can go, how much we can change and how far we can reach there. So after you've had that initial conversation to start that professional relationship, how do you maintain it in a virtual setting, especially like we've talked about where you might be geographically a million miles away from this person that you're connecting to? And so, you know, how can we leverage that initial conversation into maintenance of this professional relationship?
Yeah, again, not easy, but I set up a schedule for me. So if we talked in September, on September 20th, I'll make sure I check in, of course, before Thanksgiving, right? And I'll say, hey, it's been a while. I wanted to update you. I recently transitioned into this new role. Had to share. Thank you for the advice you gave me in September for that to happen. But also, how are things in your world? I see that your company or even your industry is leaning towards establishing ERGs. Tell me about how that's going to look. Are you nervous? Right? Like just trying to have as much of a normal conversation virtually as possible, but also with somebody who you're still trying to get to know and want to maintain that relationship. And then another thing I'll say is after that initial conversation, say, hey, well, look, I'd love to stay in touch, but really mean it. And with that, I'll follow up in about 2 months or so, whatever your timeline is, so that folks know to look out for communication from you and or keep me in mind if you come across anything. I'm super open to it.
I love that call out, both of those actually, because mm-hmm. the idea of sort of establishing a baseline of like, hey, just so I'll put a reminder on my calendar to circle back to you in a couple months. That not only gives you the opportunity to kind of like, that way you've communicated that, the other person is aware that this is something ongoing that you want to keep pursuing. But if that timing doesn't work for them, then they can say that. So that way you're not trying to, you know, wait 2 months and mm-hmm. then kind of play catch up or play, you know, LinkedIn tag a bit. And you'd be able to really like follow up with that person. It also kind of highlights the fact that like when you start this, you're starting from a general topic, right? And you might be trying to get down to a more specific one. Are there ways to do that without feeling too, too artificial? You know, like it can feel really like sometimes you when you have a specific goal in mind, but you're not really sure how to get there, it can feel like a really badly written stage play of like, how can I sort of manipulate the conversation into taking this path. But it's really easy for it to veer very quickly into either awkwardness or off track. So if you've started with general and you want to kind of steer the conversation about something more specific, do you have any tips that you'd recommend to do that?
Yeah. I need to think about that one because I'm very direct, right? Like, so I will reach out and say, again, adding a give and take, but I'm actively looking for internships right now, which is so interesting. I know I work full time and I'm looking for an internship, but here's why. And at the same time, here's what I can offer. So I think that I would say, again, going back to social stamina, reading emails, getting through all the conversations, virtual or in person, I think that it is appropriate to be as specific and direct as early as possible. But I also recognize that you don't want to be like, you know, hire me ASAP, please. And then we'll chat when we chat, which is why all the other things that Meg and I have covered so far are relevant. Stay in touch with folks, give and take. When it's somebody who has connected you through a personal connection, that might make it feel a little lighter. So hopefully all of that comes together in this answer and still makes sense. But I definitely think it's okay to put that specific ask out there, that specific direction you're looking to go in as early as feels comfortable.
Yeah, I like that. It's something that we talk about a lot is the idea that, you know, people can't help you get where you're going if they don't even know you're going anywhere at all. You know, not everybody that you meet is going to think, how can I help this other person? But if you approach it with that attitude, you'll find a lot of people are very willing to help because being asked for help not only makes you feel important, but we're kind of psychologically conditioned to want to say yes to people. So it's really, you know, it's really something you can kind of a little bit manipulate to your advantage, but you know, let's use these newly discovered powers for good and not evil. We have a question from the chat here. Hunter says that they are also a student at Georgetown, saying, I started my master's within the remote space due to the pandemic and will now be finishing my program at the end of this year. I feel like I missed the mark to really connect with my professors and classmates, which I totally understand. They want to know, do you have any quick tips on how I can connect better? So when it comes to something like this, where you're taken out of the physical space and assuming that that is how you would form connections with your classmates or with your professors, how should students pivot to this and really still, you know, create those connections that can be so incredibly valuable, you know, right after your graduation period, as well as like throughout your career? I mean, I still maintain contacts with some of my undergrad professors and they're invaluable connections. So how would you recommend people kind of make this switch or utilize the situation that they're in?
Yeah. First, hey, Hunter, hoy Saxon. A very specific Georgetown answer is to log into campus groups, Hunter. This may apply to other universities too, but Georgetown definitely use it. Use the campus groups platform. It will help you get involved and connected across campus as a graduate student. Now, more generally, outside of Georgetown, obviously office hours are a thing for a reason. They are in person now at most universities. Go, 100% go. Whether it's with the TA or the professor, they both are going to be great connections for you throughout the semester. And then if you're on campuses like the Hilltop, other universities, we always know where the free food is, where the great events are, right? Like, go to offices based on your interests. Before Georgetown, politics, yes, I knew about them, weren't really anything I was particularly invested in, but I go to GU politics all the time, right? Yes, for the free food, but also for the free events, just so that I can learn more. Georgetown is a religious institution. We have constant meditations and services. So I go to meditations when I have time. And all of those opportunities are ways to meet people, even if it's not networking per se, it still is, right? You're building connections. So trying to find as many in-person safe events that feel good for you, Hunter, based on your personal and professional interests.
Thank you so much for covering these questions. This has been so great. Before we jump, I just want to ask, where can people connect with you? Where can they support what you're doing and really continue these conversations that we've started today?
Absolutely. LinkedIn would be the best place, folks. I respond to people when they reach out to me, so I'll be sure to do that, but happy to stay connected through that platform.
Thank you so much for that, Jemay. I'm so, so happy to have shared this conversation with you. This was absolutely wonderful. So thank you so much for sharing your time and your expertise with us.
Yes. Thank you, Meg, and the Power to Fly team. Y'all have a good rest of your day.
Thank you. You too.